recorded, streamed, or podcasted. Video recordings will only capture the speaker, instructor, and students will not be visible. Your voice, however, may be captured if you ask a question. If you do not wish your voice to be captured, please speak to me in advance so we can determine an alternative means for you to participate, or feel free to write down a question and pass it to a staff member who can read it for you.
Do you need us to use these?
So you want me to use All right.
I want to welcome everyone. I'm Richard Smiraglia, and together with Hurley Lee, we're the coordinators, I think is as fancy a term as I want to use for this conference. We're very happy to welcome you to the third Milwaukee Conference on Ethics in Knowledge Organization. We're also very excited this morning to hold up this book, Ontology for Knowledge Organization, which is today published by Ergon Verlag. The first copies are on a table in the back. This is the second book from KORG, our Knowledge Organization Research Group, and there's some wonderful papers in here about ontology and ontologies, so I commend it to you as I pat us on the back. Ergon Verlag has graciously donated for our little reception this evening, which is in the Milwaukee Athletic Club, not too far from here, and our conferencier will give you instructions for that. One more thing, let me thank our students, Eng Kyung and Choi Hyung-Ju Park, who's not here, and Anne Graff, and also Laura Reidenauer, who's not here. All doctoral students with us who've helped to keep this process running. And of course, our office staff, led by Laura Meyer, and our wonderful IT staff here from Jim Schultz and his fellows. All right, Hurley.
Welcome, everyone. My name is Hurley Lee. I'm an associate professor at the School of Information Studies here at the University of Wisconsin, Milwaukee. And it is my pleasure today to introduce to you one of our guest speakers to welcome you all, Dr. Hannes Britz, our provost. And he used to be our the dean of the information school. Here, Hannes, please. Welcome, Hannes.
Thank you, Hurley. Did you find the seat?
Got lost.
I don't think I'm a guest speaker necessarily, but I will say a few words of welcome to all of you. Thank you very much. As Hurley said, I've been the dean of the school from 2005 till 2010. About 5 years, and then I became the interim provost, so this is my sixth year as the provost on campus, but my 11th year on campus, so time flies, but it's always good to be back, and I want to thank you for inviting me to say a few words. I just came from another meeting this morning at Johnson Controls, where there was about 40 males and 2 females in the engineering meeting, and I said, you know, we need more female engineers. And they talked about batteries and the future of batteries. So I said, you know, all I know about batteries is AAA when I have a flat battery. And that's the nice part of the job that I do, is you are involved in so many areas on campus and off campus, and so many disciplines and so many levels of collaboration. But my field is ethics, and I'm very proud that you continue this tradition of ethics and knowledge organization. This is, as Richard said, the third one. I think 2012, when I wasn't here, I think 2009, one colleague who flew in took the bag of somebody else. Looks exactly the same. He discovered that night in his hotel room that he actually took somebody else's bag, so he had to go back, and it was a good memory. I think, you know, what I think at SOAS makes us unique, there are many things, but a couple of things. I think we are strong organizational theory, organization of information and knowledge, the retrieval thereof, but also ethics and policy, which I think if you look at the ranking of the school, we really moved up. We set ourselves goals. We reached those goals. We want to stay strong in the field. And I think by this, having this kind of interaction provides a platform for us to really learn from one another, but also an establishment of what we believe in as true values. And I read on the website about the knowledge organization that, you know, ethics was in the background, now it's in the forefront, and actually it's part of who we are, what we think, what we do. Even though it might still be for some people in the background, we simply cannot ignore it. And I know in our field of information science, information studies, we have a value of neutrality. Now, I'm always concerned about the value of neutrality because I think neutrality is also a statement of a value, and sometimes when you're neutral, you avoid issues. So I'm not always in favor of neutrality as a value, specifically when it comes to the organization of knowledge, because the way you organize knowledge, the way you understand language, the way you present it, is indicative of embedded values that underlies many of those decisions that we are not sometimes aware of. And I think unpacking values, understanding where our values come from, and the ability to change and have an openness towards different thinking in life is so important for us as information professionals. And also, if you organize knowledge and you present knowledge, it's also one way we contribute to help other people understand their own values and change, because by reading, by reflecting, by accessing knowledge, we also change the dynamic of how we think. And I do think also very important, and I just read the in Ireland, when they overwhelmingly vote in support of gay marriages, that the Catholic Church there said, uh-oh, we now have to start to rethink our values, right? Because they want to be popular or relevant to the population that they serve. And I thought, yeah, that's true. The church in Ireland needs to rethink the way they reflect on people and on values. But also us as people, we need to see where, or reflect on where our own values come from. And be careful not to confuse values with religious values or customs or culture or legal norms. So I always think, try to distinguish that and have that openness to the truth and understand that there is no truth. The only truth, I think, is the fact that we change and that we have adapted to change and think critically all the time in the things we do. The other thing I like about the conference is I saw some of my colleagues are doing papers that I never thought would do papers on ethics. Not that they're not ethical, but okay, you know, you see people really embed their fields of music and others to really get a deeper understanding of ethical values, because it's so embedded in what we do. So really, thank you. Richard, congratulations again on the conference. I truly hope you have a fantastic time. It's not a big group, which makes it actually more in terms of sharing what you believe, and that if you go home, spend a lot of money here. Those of you who don't live in Milwaukee or in Wisconsin, because we need tax dollars to support higher education, unfortunately. So thank you very much. I enjoy your conference. Thank you. Thank you.
And I should also mention that the information ethics is one of Dr. Britt's research areas. The next person to give us some remarks is our current dean, Dr. Thomas Lipinski. Welcome, Tom.
Thank you, Hurley. As Hannes was speaking, I was trying to think the last time we were both, he and I, spoke at a conference together. We started many years ago, must be a dozen and a half years ago.
97.
We did our first paper together. And unlike Hannes, I don't particularly study ethics. I study law, but there's an interesting relationship between the two, because I think laws don't change until policymakers become informed. And so some of the work that you do is very critical to that. But I'm often fond of quoting lawyers and judges who have some interesting things to say. So I'll just give you one quote from Justice of the Supreme Court, Potter Stewart, who said, "Ethics is knowing the difference between what you have a right to do and what is right to do." And so I think this conference like this and the work that you do in terms of knowledge organizations is so important, because most of us throughout our lives, the biggest opportunity that we have to affect change in our own lives and in the lives around us is really in the work that we do and the organizations that we move in and out of. And so building that foundation and having that critical thinking about why we do the things we do and the way that we structure the world around us the way that we know the world around us, I think is the first step in reflecting upon that and then changing the law and having hopefully at least some compatibility between, again, what we have a right to do and what it is right to do. So with that, I'll let you move forward on these 2 days. I hope you have a very productive day. Unfortunately, there's some rain in the forecast, so we can't promise you perfect weather here in Milwaukee, but hopefully we can promise you, because of the work that Richard and Hurley have done, a perfect conference. So thank you.
And I'm hoping I'm pronouncing that right, because who knows, I'll just call myself an MC. Shouldn't accept a job if you don't know how to pronounce it. My job here is to keep us on track and to make sure that all of you feel welcome in Milwaukee. I'm here in the capacity of a Milwaukee native who can direct you to places to go and where the restrooms are and those kinds of things. So I plan on running a tight ship so that we can stay on schedule. I'll be sitting right there when you're presenting, so keep an eye out for this kind of stuff. The presentations will be 20 minutes, and then at the end there will be a 10-minute question and answer period for all of the presentations preceding that. In case you didn't see them on the way in, the restrooms are just right outside the door. There shouldn't be any issues with being too crowded. There's lots, so we don't need to find any overflow restrooms. We will start out with our keynote speaker, and when I introduce him, I'm calling him the man that needs no introduction, which is my way of saying he's going to introduce himself. But as you're listening to the keynote speaker, we have about an hour and a half with it, but we're hoping to have a lively discussion for that. So as he's talking, jot down some ideas that relate, and so that we can have a discussion afterwards that lasts into our lunchtime. And once lunch rolls around, lunch is on our own today, so I will introduce you to some places in the near vicinity where we can walk to. Okay. Yes.
Valeria, I just want to say one last thing because I have to leave. I just want to congratulate you on your PhD. I remember I've done it here already, but it's very special.
Yep, I'm a fresh baby doctor. Not the kind that delivers, so don't ask. Yes, it's been like 2 weeks. So one thing I do want to correct is that I wrote the wrong hashtag up here. It is EKO3 with a 3 rather than a 3 symbol. So there's a feed on the conference website that's ongoing, so you can keep an eye on that as you are going. So, yes?
I forgot to say there is free public Wi-Fi in the room.
Oh, yeah.
And our IT people brought some laptops that you can check out from them if you've not brought one on your own.
Okay.
And then one other announcement.
Do you want them signing that before they present, or just
I'll do it before, but afterwards, fine, as long as you're fine.
Okay. Sounds good. That will be part of my agenda to shepherd everyone over to IT. Okay, so we'll get started with Joseph Tennis and his keynote speech. And come on up. Get ready to introduce yourself.
Okay.
All right, I'll be using my own laptop for this, so I've got the dongle, so don't worry.
Do you need audio at all for your laptop?
No.
Sharp.
Just never be. Okay, that's plugged in. Let's get this plugged in. Good morning. Everybody's got their beverages ready to go. My name is Joe Tennis. I'm an associate professor and director of faculty affairs at the University of Washington's Information School. The associate professor part might be familiar to all of you, but director of faculty affairs may or may not. I'm responsible for a high quality of life of our faculty at the iSchool. We have about 50 people now, and we're an undepartmentalized college. So that requires a lot of paperwork that I have to do on behalf of the faculty to make sure that their life is happy. So that's my side job. I'm also the president of the International Society for Knowledge Organization for the next 3 years. It's an honor to serve in that capacity. We are a wide-ranging organization spanning multiple continents, each with their own chapters, that does work both practical and theoretical in knowledge organization work. And we have constituencies here from Brazil, which has a very active chapter. In fact, they are the largest chapter in the International Society of Knowledge Organization, outpacing Canada and the US chapter by quite a bit. I'm also the chair-elect of the Dublin Core Metadata Initiative. So if anybody has problems with Dublin Core, please tell me. I think we all have problems with Dublin Core, so I would not be surprised. But if you have any questions or gripes or praises, I'm happy to hear about that particular initiative. We just renewed the ISO standard for it, fixing a couple of things, but we recognize that there's a lot more work that we have to do around the edges of that thing, so we'll see if there's any more development that surfaces from the usage board and from the metadata initiative, which I'm happy to say will be in Brazil. The conference will be in Brazil again, or be in Brazil this year. About me, my bachelor's is actually in religious studies, so it was a comparative degree, primarily humanistic. I specialized in both Christian and Hindu thought in that context. We lived by the Max Müller maxim that to know one religion is to know none, so we have thought that, you know, in that, at Lawrence University, that that's the way we studied religion. My senior thesis was on Shakers and feminist thoughts on Shakerism. Because the Shakers believed that the second coming of Christ came in the form of a woman, Mother Ann Lee, they believed vehemently in equal rights between men and women, and they constructed their intentional communities to reflect this. There were dual leadership roles at every level, so religious and secular. There were separate entrances as well, and the work was also divided along gender lines. So women's work was done by women, and men's work was done by men. So you can imagine, second wave and even third wave feminists were trying to make sense of whether Shakers were actually feminist or not. And so I got very interested in issues of representation at that point in time, and very interested in the idea of what's an ethical representation. And so that sort of was the seed of my work that led me to Knowledge Organization. I did not know what Knowledge Organization was as an undergrad, but that was sort of the start of it for me. My MLS and SPLIS in book history is from Indiana University. I don't know if you're familiar with Indiana University, but I was there during the Cronin years. I see some nods. He's infamously known for talking about LIS as what we might call LIS, as two separate things, LS and IS. In his Shibboleth and Substance keynote speech to the ELISE conference, he talked about one being a science and one being a technique and a practice. And he argued for a separation of the two. It was very interesting times at Indiana University when I was there. I quite like him. He's a good polemicist, I guess you might say. I like his work. And my PhD is in information science from the University of Washington. I'm honored to be the first graduate from the University of Washington's information school, and it's also a joy to work there currently. My research interests are actually quite varied. I am interested in how classification schemes and other indexing languages change over time. And so the reason I'm interested in this is because we want to keep our systems working for our users, right? But if we have outdated concepts or we have relationships that don't make sense to our users, we have to revise them. And so I do a lot of work trying to look at the history of the structures and semantics of these indexing languages so that we might be able to design ameliorations in the future. We might be able to predict what kinds of changes we can anticipate and move forward. And that also, to me, has an ethical dimension, as I'll show you. The way we used to think about knowledge and the relationships that obtain between concepts changes, right? We have a different conception now than we did in 1913. And so I often reflect on ethical issues related to what is left in schemes over time, very similar to the work that Hope has done, Hope Olson has done, and others. I'm a comparativist, so I look at different regimes of knowledge organization, archival, museum, library, semantic web, and I ask questions about what are the similarities and differences in each of those regimes. And I think there might be some ethical issues there about silencing particular professions and privileging others, and we might be able to talk about that a little bit today if you're interested. So that's me. So this talk, I'm couching, that's really dark, in the context of as wide of a reach as I possibly can make it, and then I want to talk about particulars as well. This is supposed to be a map of the Earth as constructed through fuel lines. So the idea is that this is where energy is being moved across the globe because we are now in what some call the Anthropocene. So the idea that in geologic time, we can measure very large spans of time based on particular events that change the nature of the globe. And there are some who argue now that we are currently in the Anthropocene. That is, we as human beings have started to actively shape the weather, the geology, and the natural resources of this planet. And so the question, and this is going on since the Industrial Revolution, and the question that comes up for me is, are we acting intentionally or unintentionally? Likely we're doing both. So how does that reflect on the resources that we use when we do knowledge organization? How does that reflect on our work that we are privileged to do to help users in finding information and making and sense making? So I'm also very lucky to be here. I'm very lucky to be here, I'm very lucky to be alive, and I have libraries to thank for it. As a boy in a small Midwest town, I found myself different from other people and was very happy to find connections through libraries, through knowledge organization, I found out later. that represented, although a little bit oddly to me, who I was and how I could actually flourish in the world. So being lucky enough to grow up in a college town where there were university resources available, I quickly learned where the HQ76s were on the shelf and went browsing as often as I possibly could and realized that that was my roadmap out of the town and onto something better. So I'm very lucky to be here, and I have libraries, obviously, to thank for that. My job today, pardon me, is to add somehow to our store of knowledge about the ethics and ethical issues related to knowledge organization. Now, I'm petrified because I don't know whether it's all been said or not. And that's what I want to throw back at you and hopefully begin to dialogue about. When we read the literature, we often encounter very similar problems over and over again. Different case studies that surface with those problems, but we often encounter the same problems over and over again. And so the question is, do we keep talking about these cases until they amass to such a level that we take action? Or are there other techniques, are there other ways that we might disrupt what we find as ethical challenges in knowledge organization? So it's not an easy task, this task that I have, and my work here will definitely be incomplete, but I hope it's at least a partial fruitful continuation about how we practice ethical knowledge organization. Now, this is an example from some of the work that I do. This is the 1913 edition of the DDC, and this is one of the case studies that I look at the DDC, which is racial and ethnic groups. This is gypsies. You can see that at that point in time, there was a single class for gypsies, nomads, and outcast races with a very explicit note about the treatment of outcast races. At the bottom there, gypsy people have no place in the geography. Can someone else read it? Hold on. There we go, yeah. In the geographic divisions of history. Right? So at this point in time, Dewey is organizing peoples based on geography, and then we have the miscellaneous class of people with no geography, or no particular geography, at least it's understood by the editors at the time. We also see the division between language, right? Because this is the way Dewey does it. We divide things by not by topic, but by discipline. So we can look at the gypsy people as race or language, as you can see, all of those things go in that same class. So it's a bucket that we're putting a whole bunch of different things in. That changes as Dewey evolves. However, our scheme, our shelves, may or may not change depending on how long we've been living with Dewey in our collections. And so it's an interesting sort of browsing experience, as you can imagine. I'll give that example later. Now, we've been at this question of ethics in knowledge organization for some time. It seems that with the rise of identity politics, we as a society and as librarians have been working with established institutions to change terminology and conceptions about people in those terminologies. This seems to be a large part of what we focus on in the ethics of knowledge organization and at conferences like this one. Definitely identity politics has been a major driver in the work for discussions of ethics and knowledge organization, in my opinion. And I think we've made some progress, at least in forming some conversation around it. And especially with Berman's work, there have been changes done systematically, carried out systematically by knowledge organization, major knowledge organization systems. So Stephen Knowlton, in 2005, found that some 64% of Berman's recommended changes to LCSH had actually been made. So the stuff that we talk about here can have an effect. The question is it having enough of an effect? Is it having the desired effect, et cetera? Further, folks in cognate disciplines, or I think disciplines at least related, relevant to knowledge organization, have been making a lot of progress in opening up other ways of looking at terminology, other ways of looking at the world. How many people here are familiar with Mary Daly? Right, so Mary Daly, she's now passed on, but was a radical feminist liberation theologian, and felt that there was no way that women could fully become realized in a patriarchal society. There needed to be a separation from thinking in a patriarchal way, of talking in a patriarchal way, of occupying a patriarchal space. And so in her work, she would use language in such a way that she felt she was opening up a way for women to be more fully realized. She did this through her theological work, and then she constructed something she called the Wiccadary, the New Webster's Intergalactic Wiccadary, which was basically a reimagined dictionary, thesaurus, if you will, that described the words that she had been using in her theology in a particular way. And Webster's was, of course, actually a play on, you know, our good friend. But the apostrophe happened, the apostrophe was at the end, so it was a whole class of Webster's, that it was their dictionary, these women, these what she called wild women. And this is an excerpt of a piece of the art that's in there. I find contemplating the work that Daly did very fruitful, because we do have to ask ourselves over and over again in dealing with installed, existing knowledge organization systems, can we fix them, or do we need a separate space to operate in the semantics and structure that is more ethically sound for particular groups? And this is actually surfacing when we talk about Native American and Indigenous knowledge. There are some very deep-rooted methodological issues and hindrances in the designing of knowledge organization systems in Indian country. And I'll talk a little bit about that a little bit later. This audience has seen that discussion from Ann Doyle and others around these issues. And they are, I think, palpable. They are really quite powerful issues. Now, change is and always has been a major part of knowledge organization. And it's also a major part of our conceptualization of how we can act ethically in designing, implementing, maintaining, and evaluating knowledge organization systems. Almost every single outcome from a discussion of ethics in knowledge organization is some sort of change, right? That is, what we currently see isn't good enough for some reason. And so we always are talking about this concept of change. We've seen change quite a bit. We've seen it for some 140 years in the context of Dewey. When it first surfaced in 1876, it had 999 classes, and that was it. It certainly has more than that now, and many things have changed in between. And we also, if we look at the archival record, see sort of an intertextuality that happens with classification scheme change as well. That is, at the late 19th century, it was quite the vogue in the eastern United States to build your own classification system, and people would crib classes from other classification systems. And so what's interesting in this case is, well, what stays the same versus what changes has everything to do with who's got the authority and who's got the right to draw those out, right? Who's got the right to pull from those concerns. However, change has not always been motivated by ethical reasons, right? So Bechtel in 1986, on her 86th article on Warrant, comments that when we talk about scheme change, when Hume or de Grolier are talking about scheme change and the relationship between schemes and warrant, they're really looking at what they think of as intellectual history writ large, right? So the whole idea that new concepts are surfacing in the scholarly record is the real sort of reason for scheme change at those points in time. And also at this point in time, as I say, there's this idea of comparative classification. So Dewey at his school is comparing all the different schemes and trying to show, well, okay, this one's good for this reason, this one's good for that reason. Not unlike what Jens Erik Mai has been doing with his just classifications discussions. Mm-hmm. contemporarily. However, Mai is interested primarily in the ethical dimension of knowledge organization, as opposed to the structural, as opposed to the pragmatic aspects. Although Jens-Erik would never let me go by saying that he's not pragmatic, so that's for sure. So much of the change that we have seen in classification schemes is primarily structural. We might reclass something, we might move a class so that it's no longer next to something. The case, of course, with gypsies, nomads, and outcast races is that we separate those things out in later editions of Dewey, structurally making clear the semantics as different. And then we've got this beautiful tension between semantics and structure, right? Because the whole point of our indexing languages through structure is to give hints as to what the semantics actually are. But we've designed those things, we've constructed those things, and now we've got to work within those, or again, reimagine them. As Bechtel laments, not much work was motivated by semantics until we imported identity politics and conceptions of privilege into our analysis of bibliographic classification and other indexing languages. And we're still wrestling with concepts as containers and structures, such as hierarchy and polyhierarchy, as locations. So we've got containers, and we've got locations where we can put those containers. That seems to be where we're at ontologically with the stuff we've created. And we may continue to deal with these things for some time because we've constructed these tools for their utility, right? So we think that we're doing very good work for our users because, well, we're saving time for them, right? We're putting all of the things together, and we can identify what those things are. And they don't have to search the entire, they don't have to walk the entire range of shelves, reading every single title to find the things that they're looking for. We've given them a service by putting concepts in containers and placing those containers at a particular location. And then, in conferences like this, we wring our hands about the fact that we've done that. I think I find myself in a little bit of a bind here and trying to figure out what the next steps are. Because do we privilege the utility for retrieval and sense making and informal learning? Or do we do other sort of disruptive work for the sake of a kind of emancipatory semantics and structure? And it's in this context of retrieval, sense-making, and informal learning that I want to talk about constructs and construct patterns for ethical knowledge organization. Well, I'm pretty sure I'm preaching to the choir on this one. Likely. Most likely. We must fully understand that to work toward ethical knowledge organization systems and practices, we are always learning. And we are always working on change. This is because we're working with writing, writ large. And writing, if I were to muse philosophical, is the permanent misrepresentation of our thoughts. Right? We put it out there, we have to jot something down. But it isn't quite it, right? It's still missing something. It highlights some things and hides others, as we are well familiar with Lakoff and Johnson. So writing is the permanent misrepresentation of our thoughts, and that's what we're doing when we do knowledge organization. We fail, perhaps, more often than not when we write down what we're thinking. This is something we work toward improving, of course. We want to write out our thoughts and intentions faithfully and with full, to use a classification term, coextensiveness, right? We definitely want it to be faithfully represented, but we cannot, right? It's just the nature of the stuff that we're working with. So we revise, we restate, and we rewrite again and again. Elsewhere, I've talked about the aesthetics of classification and the idea that what we do is an art form or a craft. And by its very nature, resists the work of knowledge organization, resists mass production form of conceptualization. We have within the scientific management regime of library economy tried to make our work as streamlined as possible. We have tried to figure out ways in which we can conserve resources. But again, we run up against the problem of what it is that we're actually doing. We need to revise, we need to rewrite, we need to be able to re-represent. And that's not a Mark and Park kind of environment, right, if that's the case. Similarly, I feel that when we discuss the ethics of knowledge organization, we're asking for care and consideration of unique situations, particular circumstances, and we are open to learning what we've not done right, or what we have done right, or whatever we've done. We're reflective. We're looking at this work and asking ourselves, how can it be improved? Couldn't be better time. I can't imagine taking a saw to classification, but now I can actually. So thank you very much, Milwaukee. So we've got this idea that, you know, it's a craft. We're doing a kind of artisanal work in my mind when we're doing this work, and we also, because we're concerned about the ethical dimension of this, we are asking for a particular kind of care and consideration of unique situations, particular circumstances, and we're open to learning what we've not done right. At least I hope that's the case. So, with that perspective in mind, we might begin to talk about constructs and construct patterns drawn from literature, but provided provisionally as design aids. And that's what my aim is here, is to begin that conversation. How might we design better? And each of these example constructs that follow, I think it's perfectly clear that the authors wanted them to be used in understanding knowledge organization systems and practices. They are writing about these constructs in order that we might see a particular angle on our indexing languages, on our catalogs, etc. So what I'm really doing here is restating what I think they said. And what I hope to do is kind of string them together in a particular way and provide some commentary so that we can decide, perhaps as a group, what should be prioritized, what should be relegated to the dustbin, what needs to be added to these kinds of lists. Again, very provisional list, and one that is necessarily incomplete. All right, so here they are. I am going to be fancy and use the Latin here. So res ipsa locutor, the thing itself speaks, is what that means. I'm gonna talk about the concept of bound work, so to an internally consistent practice, that is internally consistent and bound with practice. And then the binarism, the levels of binarism that surfaces when we deal with our semantics and our structure in our indexing languages and knowledge organization schemes. So, I'm going to talk about these, but there are many more. So, Richard Smeraglia discusses the ethical issues with standards and resource description that fail to see objects in our care as anything other than books. His argument, following on Cutter, Osborne, and even Michael Gorman, criticizes cataloging practice and the broader work of resource description for focusing on the title page as the chief source of information and then looking for title pages in every other resource that we seek to describe in our work for our users. And in fact, Richard talks about this as bibliocentrism is the word that he coins for this. And Michael Gorman also talks about it, and he calls it deformed book theory as well. So that everything else is just a deformed book. And that we should go looking for that particular thing. So bibliocentrism here, right, is the assumption that the thing itself speaks to us, right? That it's prima facie obvious that this is going to be speaking to us. So we're focusing on the title page as the chief source of information and then looking for title pages in all resources we describe. So Richard says, quote, "It shows us that there is a long history of bibliocentrism in the library catalog. The practice of resource description has set up a multi-tiered system in which books are good and non-books are not. in which resources are described by complete transcription of their title pages, whether adequately informative or not, and where issues such as the potential uses of resources, the domain specificity of the contexts of those uses, and the cultures from which the resources arise as artifacts or in which they are intended for use are disregarded in deference to bibliographic considerations. The pervasiveness of bibliocentrism constitutes an ethical breach against the user community by preventing Wilsonian exploitation, and that's the full realization of the power of description of resources. So this is what Dr. Shmorhalia says about this lineage. Similarly, current work in indigenous knowledge organization questions our ability to describe the thing itself from the get-go. Marissa Duarte and Miranda Ballardi-Lewis, in a forthcoming classification and cataloging quarterly issue, argue for a particular technique for creating descriptive systems and practices that they call imagining. This emancipatory work starts at the assumption that what is seen is not necessarily what we know, and that we are obliged to interrogate what we describe, how we describe it, and for whom. They say, quote, "When we understand how colonization works through techniques of reducing, misnaming, particularizing, marginalizing, and ghettoizing, we can better appreciate practices that more accurately and precisely name, describe, and co-locate historically subjugated knowledge," end quote. They go on to say, quote, "Respect for indigenous holism, political realities, long-term relationship building, and patience with timelines are essential, willingness to study native systems of knowledge and context, to write about them, and to design experimental approaches is integral to shaping the theory that will inform practice. Those who wish to contribute to this area of work, especially in Native American context, must have an understanding of self-determination, sovereignty, autonomy, and decolonization, or in other words, the values and rules of law and governance in Indian country. Each of these represents a doorway into the work of imagining indigenous ontologies and how and where these take shape. We will know that a library or museum has been decolonized when indigenous patrons can both see their experiences reflected therein and also identify foundational indigenous epistemologies at play." Right? So we've attempted over the last century to standardize practice and make routine the high cost of knowledge organization practice. But we cannot design ethical systems and ethical work around those systems if we do not question the thing itself, res ipsa. But perhaps not loquitur. We need to look at the thing, but I don't think it's going to speak for itself. If we look closely at what's at play here. All right, so bound. Jens-Erik Mai talks about how classification, if it's to be just, must be bound to the practice and situated in decisions of that practice. He argues for a classification based on argument. Now, for those of you that know Jens-Erik's work, this should not surprise you. The idea of having to make an argument for a particular position is a core tenet of the work that he's done. He says, quote, "Within this framework of ethics based on rational argument, ethics has been grounded in the practice and ethical judgments can be made in the practice, pardon me, let me start over. Within this framework, ethics has been grounded in the practice and ethical judgments can be made on rational and objective bases. By placing the ethics of classification within this framework, to call a particular classification good or right is to say that it is the kind of classification that someone would choose who wanted a classification for the purpose for which this particular classification is characteristically wanted within a particular practice. Particular, 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 particular. It is thereby possible to objectively evaluate the ethical sensibilities of a given classification. For a classification to be just or good, the classification must be based in a practice, and for him, that's a domain, and not bound to particular institutions, so not bound to a particular sense of institution. The classification must actively seek engagement and justification in the activities and judgment of the practice. It must furthermore be in accord with the internal goods and standards of that practice. In the situations where the classification differs from the standard and the authority of the practice, it must do so explicitly and with justification and explanation. This requires that editors and managers of classification are conscious about their ethical and epistemological decisions. Right? So he's calling for a hyper form of reflexivity in the decisions that we make locally, so that we're bound in that context. Now, it's clear we need evidence. And this is not dissimilar to the work that I've done on ontogeny and the others have done on warrant and other concepts in designing or maintaining knowledge organization systems. We need evidence to do this work. However, it does raise an issue of what we document and why in relation to our decision making. What binding do we have to our documentation of our work? What will buttress the decision making, our rational choices, and our particular argument for why this classification is just in this particular context? In many cases, we throw up our hands and say, it's really difficult. In other cases, we really want to dive in. At what level do we document those decisions? At what level do we keep a record of how we've made the argument? And finally, I'm going to talk about this construct of binarism. It's a constant trope in discussions of ethics and knowledge organization. And I've written about this topic, as has Hope Olson. We had a friendly disagreement at the last conference here, and so that was quite enjoyable. I still haven't resolved some of the issues that I have in that context, but I'm working through them. I'm constantly learning. Our systems are decision-making systems, and we must prioritize what it is we use, what it is that we use to decide. We see in classification a particular richness and a particular shortage. It is rich in the possibility of exploration, of sense-making, and informal learning, as a guide, if you will, someone else's interpretation of what the universe looks like. But it often falls short because our priorities are to be parsimonious, right? To be as succinct and clear as possible. To not rewrite the books themselves that we are classing, right? Because that would be the true contextualization, and that's impossible. But to be a signpost along the way, that's what we're trying to do with classification. This is a kind of binarism that is fraught, but is an endless source of insight into our own theorizing about knowledge organization systems. If this is their nature, why do we wring our hands? And if we're wringing our hands, how can we change these things? With a nod to Bachrin Starr, we are working with installed systems, and so they're quite wicked problems. Next month, at the North American Symposium on Knowledge Organization, we'll see Rebecca Green talk about a revision to Dewey with regard to the treatment of North American Indians, North American Native American peoples. What is interesting about this is how this revision relates to these three constructs that I've introduced. It will be very interesting to see what is described, res ipsa, people, nations, at what level of the nation or tribe, how it is bound to practice given the methodological concerns of Duarte and Velarde Lewis, and what binarisms erupt from this kind of writing. The methods of dealing with this topic are not universally agreed upon, and the objects under description are similarly not static. Depending on what agreement or treaty a nation has, their borders shift. Whether they own their water source or not depends on which agency they have the agreement, federal agency they have the agreement with. So the whole idea that Dewey might be able to draw tidy little boundaries around this is a methodological issue, but is particular to classification because concepts are containers that are put in a particular location. Similar issues will surface in many other contexts, and what I keep thinking about is how do we manage the change? What are our methods of documentation, and how do we scaffold our understanding such that we can revise without too much cost, and more importantly, without harm? It is as though we're by creating knowledge organization systems, and specifically classification schemes, we're engaged in a constant state of informal learning that should be more like an exhibit than an edifice. That is, we might consider the work of building our structures like the laying out of items for temporary display, knowing full well that the arrangement will change and parts may very well disappear. Or we pay the price of upkeep, which is to see our systems perhaps as relics and as a testament to what once was. But I don't think that's where we want to be. I feel we can cultivate a sense of constant renewal through reflections on constructs and construct patterns, and a self-reflexivity that allows us to first do no harm, and then revise and rewrite. There are resource challenges to do this, of course, but if we are not to move forward with ethically informed knowledge organization systems, if we are to move forward with ethically informed knowledge organization systems, we must prioritize those expenditures and those resources. It seems to me we must do good work with both hands. Thank you very much. And I apologize for sounding like a preacher at the end. I have a tendency to get a little bit impassioned when I talk about these things, so I get a little zeal.
We have about 45 minutes for discussion, so and there's a lot to discuss, I think, so we can go forth with what strikes you at the moment, and then if we start to lose some steam, we can look to having structured dialogue about it, so go ahead.
Yes, I've got a question that relates to the general themes that you've been expounding on. And I'm thinking, for example, of authorship, which is related, but not exactly the classification systems you've been dealing with, but it could be in some cases. Ghostwriting, gift authorship. You can have, of course, with ghostwriting, deep ghostwriting and surface ghostwriting. How are classification experts like yourself dealing with the notion that the author is problematic, and not just in the literary sense of who's the author and all of that? I mean, actually, who's associated with those works? Should there be asterisks in the way that there are, next to Barry Bond's name in terms of how many home runs were hit in a certain year and all of that? Go ahead.
Well, I think I'll punt to Hurley and Richard, who written on this topic and explored it much more deeply than I have.
Our research group with Hurley and me as anchors, I suppose, have a stream of research on that topic. I'm sorry, we're back. And our next paper is at JDoc. It'll be out in a couple months. And Melody and Daniel are co-authors on that. What we've discovered time and time again is that there is, in cataloging, an obsession with assigning a name as author even when there isn't one. And that's like some sort of psychological need that people from constructing cataloging rules have. What we discover from the classification point of view is that, and we borrow from Foucault for this, is that authors aren't creators of works so much as they are names of classes. Within which the instantiations of works associated with the name are gathered. And that's the classification function, and we've discovered. Hurley's work with the ancient Chinese classification sort of led us to this sense of iconic use of the name, even when the person might have had nothing to do with the set of ideas present. Do you want to?
Is there any room for, let's say, a rich set of classifications where, instead of just the author, one would have this person is the true author versus the best case author versus somebody who was assigned to that unit of production because of political reasons or perhaps with the head of the research unit that this work came from? I mean, are there ways of breaking that down that are systematic? I mean, we can all tell stories about who's associated with a particular work, generate huge narratives, but I'm thinking of something that's systematic along those lines, where you could, check the box as to how closely this individual was related to that work.
I think it's very interesting. She would look up. that will be a cost issue. How do we build that in? And a lot of the modern technology, like the semantic webs, these new technologies will help us get there, but do we want that? So I think there's a series of things that we still need to consider in the next, I don't know, how many years, or maybe forever.
And this is, I mean, it's one of these things that I think happens all across knowledge organization is the closer you look, the more complex it gets, right? So you just scratch the surface and say, oh, there might be different kinds of authorship, and then you're like, oh my goodness, that's changed over time, it's really complex. The whole idea of, you know, T.S. Eliot's poems and who actually wrote them, well, you know, Ezra Pound took out tons of it. So how much authority do we have in saying that it's only T.S. Eliot's work, right? There's a lot of collaboration there in the intellectual product. When copyright comes on the scene, right, in Western culture, we shift from printer zoning to author zoning, and that privileges the concept of authorship in a different way in that context as well. So it's, you know, I call it the caveat fractal, right? It's like, don't ask the question unless you want the complexity that comes with it, because the closer you look, the more complicated it can get, for sure.
You know, you asked whether there was any systematic approach, and the answer is no. Two thoughts while Hurley was talking. First is that the best Western analogy to what she's describing are the Pauline epistles in the New Testament, only some of which probably were written by someone named Paul. And the others were written by his disciples, and the name used is an honorific, really, to gather the texts for the church, which was new at that time. In the paper that's not published yet, Daniel maybe could talk more about it, we use discourse analysis to look at these individual cases to see what they actually represent in social terms. And to do that, we looked extensively on the web to see what we could discover about how other people were referring to them. And we borrowed from Eliason and Bud a paper they gave at NASCO in this room last time when we did that. But what we discover is that RDA is like a baby step forward, because it will maybe someday, and I'll talk about this in my paper this afternoon, it doesn't yet, but maybe someday it will allow us to sort work from all the rest of the nonsense, and then when we can talk about the work in an isolated way, we can say, here are the people associated with it. But we would have to kind of convince ourselves not to need to say one of them wrote it. Because all of us who write things, we know the truth about how that happens. It's not straightforward or direct, and even when you actually do write the thing, you write 9 of them, you're not sure which one is which. And when I get up to talk, I don't know whether I deliver what I wrote. If students ask me, what did you just say? I go, I don't know. If you didn't record it, I can't. What was I talking about when I said it? That sort of human phenomenon enters into it, so there's really no way to pin it down.
A fascinating topic.
I believe the semantic web is a hoax. So anyone who believes in it might better answer that question.
Well, so I mean, what's interesting about the semantic web, if I may, is that different traditions have come to it in different ways, right? So if you come from a library lineage or tradition, you're looking at it through those lenses, because that's the way we were trained, that's our practice, that's our heritage. And other people have come from modeling, from particularly Anglo tradition of analytic philosophy. So the whole idea of how things might be structured in an information system is informed by their lineage of modeling and making things very explicit in a particular way. Entity relationship diagrams, data flow diagrams, those sorts of things are the lifeblood of many people who are involved in the semantic web. So for them, I think it would be possible to say, what do you want? We'll model it, right? If it makes sense. Whereas, many people who are coming from librarianship understand the complexities of the bibliographic plus universe and say, well, you know, we've got a pretty good work routine here. Some stuff can be improved on, but, you know, don't throw the baby out with the bathwater, right? And so there's these multiple lineages and heritages that come to this semantic web, and each one sees something different because of that background. So yeah, I've definitely been in meetings where I sit with people and they say, oh, that's no problem, you know, just do it this way. Or I watch them reinvent something right in front of me that we've had installed for, you know, 100 years in our practice. And they couldn't recognize it because it's not part of their lineage, right? And nor part of their education. So I think that's one way to think about this possibility. With all the standards, RDF, OWL, and everything like that, you can express whatever you want to express. The issue is with legacy data, the issue is with, you know, adding to the data we've got, the issue is with some of the legacy data that we do have in our online systems is messy, wrong. Do we want to add modeling to that on top of that, right? So those are some of the questions that we have to ask. I don't know if that's helpful, but it's a lot of people coming to the table at the semantic web, I think. Yeah. That's a really interesting question. Do you have something in an example in mind?
Well, I work in the health sector, so they're trying to do this all now with practice guidelines. Like, you can have the same set of evidence, and you can have three different practice guidelines depending on, you know, who's running the group and how you want to interpret the evidence. So now they're trying to write down transparency, and I think John Eric Mine talks about this a lot too. Transparency. I think about it in the food guide, like you have food industries being involved, and so the public kind of rejects it because of that's where I'm thinking of in terms of transparency.
I mean, it depends on how you in that context, it's fascinating because, you know, you're being transparent, but you still have a particular bias, mm-hmm. right? And so what you're trying to do is articulate that bias yes. in a particular way. And Jens Erik does want you to do that, right? Mm-hmm. So he says, you know, there's no such thing as an unbiased classification. Argue for why it should be this particular way. And then he runs into the ethical problems of, well, you could do a lot of harm if you unilaterally just argue for one particular view. And Melanie Feinberg does a similar thing where she talks about classifications as rhetorical spaces, right? So where there can be this room for that discussion. The potential misstep, I think, is thinking that transparency is neutrality. Right, that just because you have documented evidence doesn't mean it's right, or it's what's the course you took for sure, but you're still interested in some way, either intentionally or unintentionally interested in a particular outcome.
And what can't be captured by that transparency? Like, there's always going to be something missed. I don't know. Like, we just start routinizing more and more. I just don't know if that solves the initial problem.
Well, it's writing all the way down for me.
Yeah.
Right? So this yeah. you know, permanent misrepresentation
yes.
of what it is that we're trying
yes.
to do, no matter how big the writing gets, whether it's 575.6 in Dewey or whether it's this, you know, volume of documentation as to why you put fruits and nuts in that class,
yes.
It's writing all the way down for me as far as that's concerned.
Okay.
We're seeing the destruction of giant libraries and many, many treasure troves of paper, and I'm just wondering, do you see any loss to that in terms of classification systems? I'm just wondering, there are many kinds of loss in terms of aesthetics, in terms of how we relate to words, but I'm just wondering in terms of classification, it's a huge question. I'm just wondering if you could equip me with another argument when I battle with our librarians when another huge number of old periodicals and magazines and all that get shipped off to the dumpster. Can you tell me that, gosh, you know, if we had that, we could learn about classification systems in the past, why things were classified in a certain way, or we could perhaps get a better sense of blah, blah, blah. And maybe you know what that blah, blah, blah would be about.
I'm not sure I do, but, you know, one of the things that we in this room probably now take for granted is that we see classification not as infrastructure, right? Not as a thing in and of itself to be understood, right? And to be used in a particular way. And I think the vast majority of people think of it as infrastructure, right? It's only visible upon breakdown, right? We only know that there's plumbing in the walls when the plumbing doesn't work, right? And so when the classification fails to work, that's when people recognize it, right? Which is one of the reasons we talk about the ethics in this context. It's because that's now causing harm, or that's not a right relationship to represent in this context. As far as legacies are concerned, I mean, there are some really interesting ones in Dewey, I think. There's just fascinating things to look at the intellectual history of how, you know, we once thought about our library's collections. And, you know, this is ongoing work. For me, and many of you have heard this example already, but, you know, 575.6 in 1911 was eugenics, right? And it was a biological science. You could say that the sterilization of a population and sterilization of a population was a kind of biological imperative. You can no longer say that in Dewey, right? They've removed that. Post-World War II, you cannot say that eugenics was a biological science. You could put it elsewhere in the in different disciplines. And now they've reused 575.6 as the reproductive parts of plants in Dewey. So if you've got an old collection and you haven't done reclassification, you could browse the shelf and find, you know, early works on, you know, sort of anthropometry, you know, measuring of people for the betterment of human society, and fruits and nuts, right? So they could all be on the same class. And so those are kind of interesting examples for sure. But what people see classification doing, right, is getting them to what they need. And so they're gonna use it as infrastructure, not as a thing in and of itself. So I think it's a select few that can see that, for better or for worse.
When we work with classification in several editions, would you say that the new revisions are better than the previous ones? I mean, because if we are not working with neutrality, could we see this view that a new version is maybe better for some purposes or some institutions or activities, and that a previous edition could be used, and in that case, how to work with different versions? I mean, it's just an idea. I would like to hear your opinion.
Yeah, I'm sure that the editors of a new version of an edition of a classification consider themselves improving on, and for one reason or another, right? That's their reason for doing it, right? So that's their motivation for doing it. But I also know of instances where revisions have not been accepted by libraries. So Vancouver Public Library was operating when I was there almost 10 years ago now, in British Columbia, on three different editions of Dewey, because they didn't like the way particular classes were handled. So there's a major shift from 19 on to work with music differently, and they did not like that. And so they stayed on edition 19 with music in their collection. And then they didn't like something else from, I think it was 20. So they had 19, 20, and 21 at that time, I think, if I remember right. So they decided that it wasn't good for their user base to change, to just update the classification that way. The other, I mean, really interesting issue is data quality, right? So the idea of keeping track of particular sort of class numbers in relation to subject headings, right, is with additions especially a data quality problem, and so that may affect, you know, retrieval in those contexts as well. But I think most people try to stay up to date because they think they're doing a service to their users by staying up to date, right? It's rare that I think
change that.
But here's this assumption that we all should use the same system so we can interoperate. But what if we use each library wanted to use a different system or even a different edition of a system? Yeah, then we have the problem of interoperability. But I mean, it's also there's also the assumption that there is one system that is better than the others, and there's one edition that is better than the others, that usually is the latest one. I mean, are not there too many assumptions?
Well, and I think Von Jen will talk about this a little bit. There's this idea that, you know, standardization can actually be harmful, right? The idea that it's a colonizing effect, right, on a local culture. And we did have, IFLA did have, right, this program of universal bibliographic control, right, so that we could share. Thank you. We're done.
That's just of your talk.
Oh, okay.
We're just starting discussion now.
The idea that we could, you know, describe something once and then ship it across the network, but you know, we run into this problem of language. You know, even with the same character sets, right? We run into the problem with languages. So, you know, the idea of interoperability is a nice idea, but it comes at a particular set of costs, and we have to negotiate those costs.
Begins to make the question better for whom?
Right, exactly.
I mean, better for a patriarchal pro structure, better for a particular group that they try to improve at the expense of improving something else. I mean, not that we shouldn't try and keep chipping away at these things, but then it does make the question better for whom.
And I think that's why these kinds of conferences are important, and the outputs from these kinds of conferences are important, because the discussion has to keep going, right? So that there is a sort of, again, we're all learning. We're all in the constant state of learning. So the idea that we can keep talking about this, maybe more people will hear, and we can ask those questions more quickly or closer to the source, or, you know, more of us are asking those questions, ideally.
We can't forget about warrant, too. I mean, yeah. Times sometimes dictate where things go. I did some work, kind of related work, that looked at transgender and intersex people and women throughout the history of Dewey. And intersex people are all over the place because, you know, they're trying to decide scientifically where it should go, and, you know, and it bounced around. Someone's back here.
I did that.
Sorry, I interrupted.
Yes. You live in the shadow of Microsoft and Bing and all of that. Google's not that far away. And I'm just wondering, have these huge search services had some impact, if only with their shadow, on what's going on in the discussions concerning classification and research concerning classification? Because this, some forms of search could be making some users' usage of classification systems different in some ways. And so I'm just wondering how these two worlds are interacting.
Well, they've I guess fixed it now, but for a while you actually couldn't find anything sort of socially related to bisexuality in Google, because it was considered a kind of stop word. So the whole idea that you could find support groups was completely rendered invisible because they put it on this sort of medical scientific term list. So that's, they fixed it because enough people protested. I've got some good screenshots from when it happened, so I use that in teaching sometimes. So that's one thing. Recommendation engines of all sorts, right, relate to classification, and again, it's visible upon breakdown. So Walmart trying to recommend movies to you, there was this major snafu where they were putting out all this stuff on African American history and, you know, civil rights, and then Planet of the Apes shows up because the recommendation engine was classifying in a particular way, right? And so that was a made that pulled it down, right? So all of these things, again, most people think of it as infrastructure. Oh, it's no big deal. I use language every day. I know exactly how it works. I know the kind of associations I have, and, you know, only when you see something violate your own assumptions about how things should be put together, do you realize, oh, that's a thing.
There's a similar phenomenon with the term black limit. It goes to porn sites.
And, you know, one of the other, I mean, that's, yeah. So, and same thing with Twitter, right? The idea of hashtags and what's associated in what hashtags and that kind of stuff. It's all surfacing because we're writing all the time and we're making associations between things all the time in the digital environment.
I was wondering if anyone can speak to the practical exercises they give their students for critical information literacy. So to be able to see these things more clearly, I remember when I was in library school, they had us do an assignment going out and trying to find bias within the system. But I wonder if there's other ways that it can be taught so that people can see the ethical assumptions being made practically. We can show them examples, which would be helpful. But any other way that they can get involved, I don't know.
I do two lectures on critical classification, and I'm trying to think of the exercises. I mean, I have some students sort of look at, you know, Wikipedia categories to see up and down whether or not there's anything that they can find there. But I've used a lot of examples in class, but now that you've given me this challenge to find an exercise, I think I'm going to take it, and I'll think on it for a day or two and see if I can get back to you. And maybe everybody else can too, or somebody else might have an exercise to share. But I do a lot of examples and say, look out.
Oh, well, unfortunately, I'm not teaching anymore because the program for school librarians that I taught cataloging in is. But something I used to do when I was teaching cataloging to future school librarians was to have them look at SIP records and to think of, for the resources that we were looking at, needs that they might address that wouldn't be accessed through the assigned subject headings, and to try to get them to think through what access was missing and what kind of was the default received treatment.
Well, yeah, I wanted to say something about how I think the knowledge organization community needs to become more aware that in the digital world, classification means something different. And that the digital world is classified, but not using the bizarre schemes that we create. Joe and I were at a conference in the Netherlands, and it was kind of interesting because I guess we and a couple of people there were sort of representing the structured bibliographic classification world, and the others were all in the digital world, and we all felt like we were looking at exhibits in some kind of zoo. You know, oh, look, there's those weirdos. But the whole rest of the world classifies, we use the word classification, their systems are expensive, and they function really in much the same way we want ours to, but they're not bibliographically based or particularly moronic based. So both communities need to talk together and learn more about each other. I think that's really important.
More thoughts?
Yeah.
Well, this is something really contemporary that's happening, and so it might be too new for everyone to really know about it. But the Library of Congress is piloting this vocabulary for demographic groups. And in the beginning of May, they put out a description of the project and a tentative list, and currently have a call out for feedback. And it's the idea is to improve access in faceted displays. They want to separate out the demographic aspect of works as a genre form question, so that the examples that they give are users wanting to find things like novels by lawyers or handbooks for nurses. I mean, and these are pretty kind of, the examples that they give are not the ones that raise all of the, yeah, the questions and problems, because the terms do include ethnic and racial groups and things like gender identity and sexual identity and that sort of thing. And I mean, there's a couple of a very straightforward, like just out and out dramatic problems in the draft that I think people have commented on, and I have hope, maybe naive hope, but I mean, I think that those will probably get fixed. I mean, for me, it's a really interesting dilemma between pragmatism and the larger questions, because of course, as a, you know, as someone who works in a library, I'm very aware that like users do ask these kind of questions, and it is, I mean, it is meeting a clear demand and being able to clearly answer those kinds of questions. But it's also, I mean, it's so fraught, you know, and I've actually seen people respond to the draft by saying, we just shouldn't do this at all. Like, this is just too sticky and too problematic. And I really, and I'm not quite there yet. I mean, because I do see, I mean, it seems that the most grave problems would take place at the level of implementation, and that really hasn't been addressed yet at all. But anyway, so I was just curious if other people are following that, have seen it, and what you think. And if not, you know, definitely go check it out, because they are soliciting feedback right now.
Is it from the public or from just library professionals or information professionals?
I don't think they are explicitly saying who can comment. I mean,
okay.
But I think it's assumed that probably most people will be.
Is Dewey, on the Dewey blog, they put out white papers and asked for input, and they put out a white paper asking for recommendations on how, what they should do with asexual, transgender, and intersex a few years ago, and there were like five responses, and they ended up putting it in the final result. They fixed their original proposal, was horrendous, and there was some improvement in their, what they actually implemented, but it still was not great. And Rebecca Green moderates this, and she said, we never get that much feedback from it, you know, and I think it's a good effort, like, hey, let's get some subjectivity from the people, but the people, it's, you know, that's just one little tiny avenue that's not really that effective. So, I mean, there needs to be some other more systematic way, maybe. More thoughts. We, according to our schedule, we have 15 minutes before the break starts. If we're all done with our discussion, we can start a little sooner, get us 15 minutes more at the lunchtime at the end. Is that, since we have